I'd like to begin by thanking the Human Rights Resource Center for inviting me, and thank you, David. The topic for my presentation is mitigating the hazards of economic integration for vulnerable groups, in particular women and children. I think it's also worth mentioning that I think this is a very good way to continue the panel, because where Mary ended her conversation by talking about really ASEAN integration for whom, my focus is really going to be on one particular or one particular dimension of the ASEAN integration and looking at specifically at how the integration will benefit or impact women and children and other vulnerable groups. I also want to mention, and I think this is because I'm also seeing a number of familiar faces in the room, people who I have met with in the ASEAN over the last year. This particular presentation is based on a research that was conducted by the ASEAN Secretariat and UN Women, which looked at the gender dimensions of the ASEAN economic integration. So a lot of the content that I'll be presenting is actually available online in the report, and I would encourage all of you to look at it, because it's fairly data heavy and it's there's a lot of details. So very briefly, I think what I want to talk about is touching upon the topic that Mary also mentioned, is that when we're talking about trade integration and regional integration, why are we talking about the human rights component or looking at the social dimension of the economic integration in the same place? Like, what is the need for talking about this? And specifically, if we are talking about the inequality, the gender inequality, the inequality between men and women, why do we talk about that in the context of trade integration? The topic is looking at, you know, hazards of economic integration. And what I want to say up front is the hazard is not so much that the economic integration is directly creating hazards for a specific group. The hazard is because all groups are not able to access the benefits equally. So it's very important to understand why is it that not everyone, and specifically the inequality that I'm talking about is between men and women, why is it that they are not able to benefit equally from economic integration or from any kind of economic benefits that trade will bring about? So I do want to talk about women's participation in the ASEAN labor market that actually creates hurdles for them from benefiting in the trade expansion. I will talk about how the women's participation in the ASEAN integration is going to be impacted as the integration takes place, like the projected, you know, how will it impact going forward. And in the context of the ASEAN, the AEC, it's also important to look at the specific sectors. And the different participation of different groups within these sectors, because one of the key ways in which the AEC is taking place is not that trade is going to open up for all sectors equally. There are specific sectors that have been identified that are the ASEAN priority sectors where trade is going to be completely open. There are 11 sectors in particular, and there are 7 skilled trade economic professional categories in which there's going to be free movement of labor. So while it might seem that AEC is all encompassing, actually it's not. It is still happening in a fairly phased way. So it's important to see how different groups participate in these different sectors and how that's likely to change or create opportunities or what are the barriers to their participation in these particular sectors. And finally, of course, ending with some recommendation on how do we create a more level playing field between men and women so that they can both benefit from the integration process. So this is similar to what Mary talked about. There are 4 pillars of the ASEAN economic integration. What we do know, when I see this figure, what always strikes me is that there's a complete, what I see missing is, where are the people? You know, I don't see the word people mentioned anywhere. I'm very happy to see that the 2025 has specifically mentioned people. The only place where I see that, you know, potentially when we talk about economic integration and the word people is probably in the equitable economic growth, economic development pillar. But even that is very limited to just SME development, which is a bit, you know, unsatisfying. So the focus is very heavily on trade and investment promotion. There isn't much of a focus when we talk about the equitable and inclusive growth. That still remains a challenge because within the AEC structure, inclusive growth was not very clearly defined. And what does it mean by inclusive growth? What are we talking about? And you know, there is still very high levels of social, economic, as well as political inequality between men and women. So there are all dimensions of inequalities, you know, while we say the poverty levels are decreasing, but we know that inequality exists, is fairly common in the region. The graph that was shown in the previous presentation on inequality, which shows that it still remains a concern. The inequality that I'll be focusing on is just looking at between men and women. The starting point is really when we think about ASEAN, it is an economic powerhouse. It is right now the seventh largest economy in the world. It is expected ASEAN collectively will be the fourth largest economy by 2050. It is a growing consumer demand hub, 67 million consuming class. The macroeconomic indicators, when you compare it to some of the developed countries, it is very, very good, it's very stable. The government debt is under 50% of GDP, which is a very stable indicator of macroeconomic progress. It has the third highest real GDP growth. ASEAN is the fourth largest exporting region in the world. And the AEC is expected to boost all these different dimensions of ASEAN integration. However, what we also know is that AEC, or the integration that is taking place, takes place on an underlying highly unequal region. There are social and economic inequalities that exist in the region. So while you have at one level the countries are expanding at a very high level, that they are an economic powerhouse, but the underlying inequalities are very, very significant. So why are we talking about it? Why does it matter that there is inequality? The reason why it matters is that we know that trade expansion creates opportunities for employment. It creates opportunities for jobs and growth. However, if there are existing inequalities, then the gains from the trades are not going to be homogenous. That you're essentially having an expansion at an underlying base that is highly unequal. So when you think about a race, you know, we're all following the Olympics. You think about the race and you have different starting points for different people in the race. That's exactly what is happening in the economy. You have people at different starting points. And especially when you think about men and women, the starting point between men and women is very different. We're all competing in the same race. The end point is the same, but we're all at different starting points. And that's exactly, and in the context of that, if you say, okay, we're going to suddenly expand the field, we're creating more opportunities for you, but your starting point still remains different. We have to take into account that. If that happens, then the benefits that you get from this expansion is not going to be homogeneous. So while from an economic point of view, you might say that the economic policy itself does not create, discriminate between men and women or against other vulnerable groups, but it does discriminate because it does not take into account the existing inequality. And that's what makes it a discriminatory trade policy, because it's not taking into account existing different starting points for different groups of people. So at this point, what I would say is that the AEC is completely gender blind. It's not taking into account the fact that men and women in the ASEAN countries are at different starting points. There are significant barriers for women to participate in the economic progress of the region. And on the other hand, I think it's also important to realize that while the discriminatory, while this kind of inequality is not a great sort of social outcome, it also has impact on how trade benefits the economy. Because the overall gain from the economic integration, the trade integration, will not be optimal if there are inequalities. So, you know, just quoting President Obama, who I think last week said that when there is, when everyone is equal, we're all better off. That's essentially the core concept that we're talking about, is that when we're trying to improve the overall growth of the economy, and if you have such significant inequalities that exist between different groups of people, then the overall benefits from trade will actually be less than optimal than what you would expect. So that's why, so final, I mean, my starting point, I'm putting my, you know, my personal bias on the table, is that the trade expansion that's taking place in the ASEAN is not gender neutral. It's in fact, I think, gender blind right now. What we do see in ASEAN is that there's been a rapid expansion of both intra-ASEAN trade as well as extra-ASEAN trade. What this implies, as well as in foreign direct investment. So on the left-hand side is the increase in trade, and on the right-hand side is the increase in foreign direct investment. The important takeaway, without looking at specific numbers in this, is that we see that, that both intra and extra ASEAN trade and FDI is increasing, which means that the AEC is not at the cost of one versus the other. That there is an increase in both intra and ASEAN. So the overall trade from the region is expanding. However, what is the female share of these exports? And this is where I think it gets really interesting. There does not exist a metric that allows us to measure the female share of export. So we have to construct this. What we did was that if we look at the total labor contribution to the export, and we think of it as male intensive factors of production and female intensive factors of production, and you break it up by different countries, we are able to get some kind of a quasi measure of what would be the female share of exports. And as you can see, that the female share of export is a very, very small percentage of the total exports from the region. The different colors are for different countries, and while the overall exports have expanded, the female share of exports have remained more or less constant from 2000 to 2013. I'll come back to this later on when we talk about what will happen until 2025. If the same levels of female participation continues, how do we expect this figure to change? We'll come back to that. So, what we do have right now, so far what we've covered, is that trade is expanding, exports are expanding, but the female share of exports is very small. We also more or less agree that it's very important to have an equal starting point for different groups of people, especially men and women, because women are 50% of the population. So why is it that we see such a small share of women in the total exports? What is the reason? Some countries say, well, women don't participate because they're not as educated. But, you know, on the contrary, what we do see in the ASEAN region is that the mean years of schooling has been improving significantly. So mean years of schooling in the ASEAN countries, especially in the post-primary and secondary level, is very high. In some countries, like Brunei and Singapore, there is almost 100% parity between men and women, and especially in the tertiary education levels. However, when you look at the distribution by the kind of jobs that men and women do, you find that women tend to dominate the more clerical and the more elementary occupation. So what you have is that you have an educated workforce, educated by most global standards, but you have a smaller share of women doing the high-skilled jobs. You have more women concentrated in the low-skill and the elementary occupation. So it's not surprising that the gender wage gap in the ASEAN overall is 17%. That means women are earning 17% less than men overall. And there are various reasons for this, right? I mean, we can think about all kinds of reasons. Education is definitely, I think, in this case, not a reason. So, when we look at this, and again, I don't want us to focus on like the specific in which country is doing what, and you all have the slides for this. As I said, you know, there's a report on this that's online, you can take a look at that. But what for me is very interesting is that we plotted the female and the male labor force participation of 1990 to 2015 for the data that was available. That's a 25-year period. And what we find the striking thing for me is that the difference between male and female labor force participation is almost constant across all countries. In some countries it's small, in some countries it's big, in some countries it's reducing, but it's still there, and it's a fairly high gap between male and female labor force participation. There's also a gap in the decent work between men and women. When you look at the percentage of women in vulnerable employment versus men in vulnerable employment, you find that in almost all the countries you have a greater share of women in vulnerable employment. Gender wage gap, again, it's a persistent gender wage gap. Surprisingly, one of the highest gender wage gaps is in Singapore. But the gender wage gap, I mean, not singling out any specific countries, but it exists across almost all the countries in the region. There are many possible explanations, right? If you have a large number of women in vulnerable employment, not contractual jobs, you will have a higher gender wage gap. That just seems to be a logical thing. We talked a little bit about this in, you know, when you're talking about ASEAN has been focusing a lot under the equitable growth pillar. One of the only sort of goals is SMEs. And SMEs are definitely has to be recognized that they are a big source of employment in the region. But however, what we find is that except Philippines and Vietnam, the female ownership in business is quite low in almost all the countries. You know, one of the reasons that has been identified as fairly easy to identify is that women's access to financial institutions is very low. Why is women's access to financial institutions very low? Probably because of the lack of women ownership of resources that they can use as collateral. So it's all linked. I mean, it all keeps coming back, you know. You have an educated workforce, but women are in low-skilled jobs. You have a gender wage gap. You have few women business owners because you have lack of, you have limited women, access to financial institutions. Why is it that, again, women have fewer resources that they can use as collateral? However, and this is something that I always come back to, is that one of the main reasons, you know, if you have an educated workforce, you have a, you have a large number of, fairly large number of women business owners, but why is it that you still have so few women in the workforce? I mean, what is the reason why we're not able to get more women in the workforce? And I think one of the main reasons is social cultural norms. And while most of the ASEAN countries have ratified the CEDAW, we still find the existence of institutional and legal barriers across almost all the countries. Different levels, different kinds. But the fact is that, while equality, while most constitutions in the region, accept that men and women are equal, there are different kinds of barriers that exist. And these are the barriers that need to be really addressed. I know that a lot of countries, and I'm looking around the room, I know a lot of countries have now very specific forms of gender mainstreaming that they have in place, that they are tackling these kind of institutional legal barriers. But the fact is that in many countries, I mean, I'm just taking some examples, like Indonesia and Myanmar, customary law in some provinces takes precedence over constitutional law. In Malaysia and Singapore, personal law is recognized as a valid source of even in instances where it violates constitutional provisions for non-discrimination and equality. In Indonesia, the marriage law explicitly states that men are the head of household. And in Brunei and Malaysia, married women are required to, by law, to obey their husbands. So these are the kind of, these are some of the things that exist in the law that perpetuate the inequality between men and women, and that also need to be addressed in order for us to address economic participation, in order to make sure that there are more women in the workforce and taking advantage of the opportunities that the AC is bringing about, we need to go all the way back to our social cultural norms as well as to our legal structures to make sure that we are getting rid of these kind of barriers that exist. Summarizing, we have the low female labor force participation, we have the education attainment gap is narrowing, but it indicates that there are other factors that explain women's low economic participation. There's a persistent gender wage gap, institutional discrimination to women access continues. And one of the main reasons I think that keeps coming up, and the reason in addition to whether there's a skill gap or there are institutional barriers, is the limited childcare options that exist. I think a number of countries have looked at the national action plan on gender, and many of the countries, people, you know, they have talked about shared parenting. There's a lot of push from the government side in creating childcare options, but really this is not something that has been systematically addressed. So in order to get more women in the skilled, high-paying jobs, we need to address the fundamental issue of women's care responsibilities. So what happens in the context of this? So you have AEC coming up, you have expansion of trade, you have this extremely unequal situation between men and women, you also have institutional barriers. What happens as a result of this when the AEC does come about? So just projecting the female share of export to 2025. What you find is that if the same level of participation between men and women, the same level of female participation continues, what you will end up is in a situation where in majority of the country, the female share of export is actually going to decline. So we already have the situation where the female share of export is fairly small, but if the same level of participation continues, only two countries will see an increase, which is Singapore and Cambodia. Cambodia is seeing a large number of females coming into the workforce, especially in the garment sector. We can talk about the conditions of work in specific sectors, but the fact is the overall female share of work in employment is increasing in Cambodia. But in most other countries, the female share of exports is going to decline. How will AEC affect female wages and employment? What we're seeing right now is just a projected increase in the wages and employment, and what we find is that in most cases there is an increase in both female and male wages, but the increase in male wages will be more than female wages. What we also predict is that employment will increase for both men and women, but the increase in employment will be more again for men than women. So essentially what we are in a situation where the inequality between men and women is likely to continue in the post-AC period all the way up to 2025. So our women, what about the priority sectors? And I don't remember the specific priority sectors, but they are agro products, automotive, electronics. What about women's participation in the sectors, in the specific priority sectors? What we do find is that there is an increase in exports from the priority sector. So the overall production in the priority sectors is increasing, but the share of the high-skilled sectors, which is the automotives and electronics, is far higher than the priority sectors that women dominate. And the sectors that women dominate are the agro products, are the agricultural sectors, they're also the garment sectors. And here, the increase has been relatively stagnant. So that is another thing. So while we're looking at the macroeconomic sort of, and the women's participation at the macroeconomic level, even when we look at the sector specific, it's not a very good picture. Because what you have is a situation where the sectors that are expanding are not the sectors where women tend to dominate. There are other sort of non-priority sectors like financial services and oil and gas that also have a large share of the ASEAN exports. But again, women's role, women's participation in these sectors is very, very limited. When the oil and gas industry in Malaysia and Brunei, which is one of the largest probably in the world in terms of the share of exports, the participation of women in the sectors is very, very small. And mostly in the clerical jobs, participation that does exist. So while there is, I think each of the sectors provides opportunities for women's participation, there is opportunities in agriculture, in tourism, in garments, as well as financial services, but more needs to be done in order to take advantage of these opportunities. In almost all the cases, what we say is that we need gender responsive policies and we need social protection. We need to set up a system in place within the gender machinery so that they are able to work with the other line ministries. So whether it's an agriculture or a textile and garments or financial services, the gender machinery within the country should be resourced in a way that they're able to work with the other line ministries. I think that we have colleagues in the room who have worked on gender mainstreaming, and they know the challenges that exist in trying to work with the economic ministries. The minute we start talking about gender mainstreaming with the trade or finance, it becomes a very, very difficult challenge for us. We need resources, technical capacity, as well as financial capacity. So finally, just concluding, I think overall, there's a lot of opportunities that AC brings. I think specifically, if we talk about SME as a growth engine, there's definitely opportunities for creating equality between men and women's economic participation. There is a boost in paid formal employment opportunities. There's also employment in specific BIS sectors. I think as long as we're talking about more skilled job creation. But there are significant barriers that we cannot ignore on both the demand side and the supply side in the labor market that are inhibiting women's participation in the labor market. The high skill sectors that women are participating in are stagnant. The newly created jobs, they are just promoting gender stereotypes. And this is just based on my experience. What I find is that a lot of ASEAN countries have very very well laid out TVET programs. But often the kind of jobs that are the kind of skill training that is being given to women are just, they are very typical gender stereotype kind of training. Whether it's in beauty, salon training, it's not really talking about training in the high-skilled, high-paying jobs. So we really need to start thinking about what are we talking about skill creation and why are we not doing skill creation that are targeting the ASEAN priority sectors so that women can take advantage of these opportunities. And then finally, women continue to be segregated into the low-paying and short-term contractual jobs. In the supply side, the gender gaps in education is decreasing, but women are still less educated. There is also gender gaps in skill, credit, decent work opportunities. There's large number of highly educated women remain unemployed. And I think this for me would be the most concerning thing is that, we are talking about a highly, an educated women workforce that is not finding employment. We have to really think about why is it that, they are not able to be gainfully employed. And safety at workplace is a major concern. I think most of the countries talk about workplace harassment within the labor laws. I think a few countries have separate workplace harassment laws in place. And workplace harassment, safety at workplace is an issue that needs to be addressed upfront. Again, when we're talking about educated, employed women staying at home, workplace harassment and safety at workplace is a big concern in getting the women out in the workforce. So conclusion is that AC will create opportunities, especially in the BIS sector, where the gender differential patterns of employment and wages will persist. Women will probably continue to earn less and remain employed in the low-skill sectors, unless direct interventions are taken. We need to directly target the barriers that are keeping women back. Some recommendations that I think, how do we do this? How do we sort of mitigate this situation? I think at the ASEAN level, and this is something that I've been, I think is very, very important. So far, again, we have an ASEAN, we have the AC, which is talking about a people-friendly AC, but it is not really talking about what it means for different groups of people. Who are the people? And at least to begin with, we need to start talking about men and women and acknowledging the differences between men and women and men and women's participation in this economic integration process. So there needs to be some way of gender monitoring of the AEC and getting rid of the silo effect where we have the gender issues and the children issues is under the social pillar, but the economic issues are under the economic pillar. There needs to be some way in which we are talking about gender mainstreaming at the ASEAN level. It could be indicators such as the amount of public expenditure on women and children. That's an easy sort of indicator about the amount of public allocation and expenditure, the amount of investment on women and children could be some of the possible ways in which we can start talking about monitoring the social impact of the AC. I also think that it's very important for us to talk about free movement of labor, because so far the emphasis within AC has been the free movement of capital. But the free movement of labor is also important because I think that the way it exists right now, the labor movement in the seven skill categories is actually discriminatory towards women. Because those skill categories are not necessarily the ones where you have more women employed. Most of the women are working in the low skill and semi-skill categories that have not been covered by the AC. So it's very important to really think about what is it that we're talking about when we talk about freer movement of labor in the AEC context. We can also think about, you know, creating fiscal and tax incentives for countries to encourage more women participation. You know, clarify policies. I think you know, most countries in the ASEAN have signed on to the ILO convention that talk about non-discrimination, but it has not been clarified what is non-discrimination when it comes to gender means. It's very important to clarify what does it mean when you're employing a man over a woman, and what does it mean when the in terms of the gender implication of the non-discrimination clause of the ILO convention. The legal constraints to women's participation needs to be looked at, and also looking at the workplace harassment and creating safer working environment for women. There are also several things that can be done at the national level for boosting women's participation in the AEC, whether it's creating, bridging the education and skill gap, whether through cash incentives, scholarships, subsidized loans, you know, especially in the skill sectors. We can talk about, you know, subsidized loans for more women entrepreneurs and getting more women access to financial institutions and loans. And essentially, it means really reforming the entire child care and the care system, family support system at the country level. You know, looking at gender neutral use of flexible work arrangements, and not penalizing women for taking time off. So really thinking about how does the entire care policies in the country works in creating a level field for women. And reforming the pension systems, essentially, you know, to ensure that the maternity leave does not penalize women when they take time off. That's one very specific thing that can be done. And I just want to end with this, is because this is not my calculation, this is an IMF calculation. At the end of the day, while you know, making sure that economic growth benefits men and women is important from a human rights perspective, it's also important for economic growth, because there is an economic cost to gender inequality. In the ASEAN context, the economic cost of gender inequality varies from 7% in Cambodia to 29% in Brunei. That is the loss of GDP that is there because of unequal participation of men and women. So I just want to end my presentation with that.